Bun găsit la Meet Your Map. Războiul din Afganistan s-a încheiat cu retragerea forțelor SUA și aliaților săi, inclusiv ale României. Mulți au comparat imaginele din Afganistan din 2021 cu retragerea precipitată a forțelor americane din Vietnam. Disperare, teamă, copii aruncați peste gard de părinți afgani către soldații americani pentru a fi salvați. Mai mult, pe 26 august, în plină operațiune de retragere, un atentat terorist la aeroportul din Kabul, atribuit organizației teroriste ISIS-K, a ucis cel puțin 182 de oameni, inclusiv militari americani. Ce aduce situația din Afganistan, României și, în particular, și Europei în general? Crește riscul terorist în Europa? Va putea România să facă față unui val de refugiați din Afganistan? Cum va evolua angajamentul SUA pentru securitatea țărilor din Europa de Est? Încercăm să dezlușim aceste evoluții și am invitat la Meet Your Map 3 europarlamentari, 2 români, Vlad Nistor de la PNL, grupul Partidului Popular European. Bună ziua, domnule Nistor!
Bună ziua!
Nicolae Ștefănuță de la USR Plus, grupul Renew Europe. Bună ziua, domnule Ștefănuță!
Bună ziua!
And we also invited Mrs. Elena Ionceva from the European Socialists and Democrats. Mrs. Ionceva is a member of the European Parliament on behalf of Bulgaria and a former journalist with extensive war zone experience. Welcome, Mr. Ionceva.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this invitation from Hot News.
Okay, I'll start with Mrs. Ionceva. You negotiated behalf S&D Group the European Parliament's resolution on Afghanistan. Please tell us what is all about in this resolution, Mrs. Ionceva.
Yes, the resolution that was adopted, it's with a strong majority in the European Parliament, and it's a strong on the humanitarian situation and the need to prevent Afghanistan becoming a safe haven for terrorists. And it's crucial of the failed policy over the past 20 years and includes very important text on the need for further reflection on strategic autonomy and EU foreign policy and defense policy, very important points. And the resolution included many other points, such as the need to resume safe evacuation, of course, step up humanitarian aid, give specific attention to women, girls, to different vulnerable groups. In the resolution, we acknowledge that we need engagement with the Taliban. Yes, we are not recognizing them, but we need to have our leverage of influence. We need to talk them in order to help the situation there to not deteriorate. Also, in the resolution, we are talking about the human asylum policy, expanding resettlement, the recent asylum cases, no forced returns, that's very important, and to use of the temporary protection directive and humanitarian visas as well. And of course, we are addressing lessons learned and the future of the European Union strategic autonomy. And we are talking about the role of the opium. You know that opium, it's the opium and the production of heroin is fueling different terrorist group. So we think that the European Union can work to that direction, to decrease the opium production in Afghanistan, because the serious destabilization threat coming from opium production and trade, it's quite important. You know, the negative impact of opium goes far beyond Afghan borders to our European borders. Afghanistan is producing more than 80% of the world opium and heroin. And we, the Europeans, we are using 95% of this opium. It's a big, it's a danger for the European security. So just I'd like to draw your attention to one fact, very interesting. The number of people who died of heroin overdoses in NATO countries per year is 10 times higher than the total number of NATO troops killed in Afghanistan. So can you imagine this? So we need to speak, and we need to take some important steps in order to prevent this situation in Afghanistan with this large production of opium. If you want, we can discuss a little bit further in your TV.
Mr. Nistor, how do you assess the future situation with the Taliban regime in Afghanistan for Romania and the EU in general in terms of security threats, a new refugees crisis? Maybe Romania and Bulgaria are here at the outskirts of the European Union.
First of all, the war itself was a disaster. For 20 years, costing around 300 million per day, all the allied countries with no results. And I think that this is the most important thing here, because what we see today, the realities, the political, social, economic, cultural, human rights realities in Afghanistan are almost the same as they were 20 years ago. That means that all the human lives, or first of all, human lives, including Romanians dying there, all the financial efforts were for nothing, or almost for nothing. Secondly, the retreat, the moment of ending the how it was organized was even more disastrous than there were in 1975 in Vietnam. Because in 1975 was around 45, 46 years ago, the political, the strategic, the technological realities today are different. But the organizers of this retreat made enormous mistakes. Third, the attitude of the allies concerning the persons who helped them was also an abnormal one. For example, there were countries who tried to do more, like Italians, for example, or like Polish, the Poles. Romanian is not included in this category. I heard a Romanian veteran, a general fighting in Afghanistan, who said that a lot of Romanian lives were saved with the cooperation, direct cooperation, of their Afghan colleagues. And in the moment of our retreat from there, in the first moment, there were only five persons who were extracted from there. And the argument of the Romanian government was that it was difficult because they hadn't a clearance, a security clearance. But we were there for 20 years. In 20 years, we can make all the security clearances in the world for the persons who cooperated directly with the Romanian forces and with the Romanian government there. Today, of course, I heard Joseph Borrell's declaration, and he's really right. I heard also Ursula von der Leyen's declaration. She was also right. We must have contact with the Taliban, the new Taliban regime in Afghanistan, but we don't know exactly what will they do in the next period. They seem to be more civilized today, but there are a lot of signs of uncivilized attitudes against the opponents, the journalists, mainly women. The former judges, mainly women, and so on and so forth. The reality is a very difficult one. Now, globally, we have a new challenge, and Romania is directly involved in this, because Romania was one of the main participants there, had, I don't know exactly, something like 32,000 soldiers in 20 years in Afghanistan. And that means that Romania can be in danger if the terrorist attitudes will come back, and if Afghanistan will become again a terrorist heaven as it was 20 years ago.
Okay, Mr. Minister, you just criticized your own government because...
I criticized Romania, not my government now, some political attitudes. I already did that. I declared this at another site. It was obvious. It's a reality. We, as all our allies, it was better to do more than we did. Even if Joe Biden declares that the retreat was a victory, I don't think at all. I am a very pro-Atlantic supporter, but on that occasion, all the democratic forces of the good part of the world didn't do it as good as it can do, in good as it could do, and the results were, we saw them. It depends how the Afghan government will act in the next period of time. I understand that after 20 years of disastrous war, everybody wanted to put an end to these, but I think that diplomatically and militarily, it was it's possible to do differently. And the second thing, very, very clear, and even Ursula von der Leyen day before yesterday made a statement on this subject. Of course, now Europe must have a military force of rapid reaction. That's a subject discussed long time ago, became this discussion, with no results, and the fact that Europe didn't have a corp, a military corp like that, was obvious on that occasion.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Ștefănuță, you heard Mr. Nistor's, let's say, words about the Biden administration and the American government in general. What can you tell us about, you are the vice chair of the European Parliament's delegation for the relation with the United States. What can you tell us? How can you assess the future interest of the U.S. in Europe and in Eastern Europe in particular, and mostly in Romania after this Afghanistan retreat? Could we see a larger retreat of the U.S. influence and cooperation from the world scene of power and the global stage?
Yes, then I will say the following. I'm the vice chair for relations with the U.S. and a very strong transatlanticist. I believe this is a very, very important relation for us, especially for us who are at the Black Sea. We have to remember that it is the Americans who are mostly at the Black Sea. We have to remember that it's the Brits who are mostly at the Black Sea. We have to remember it's NATO fundamentally. Now, I agree with what my previous interlocutor said. There is an intervention fatigue. And we will see NATO probably being more skeptical about going beyond its initial scope of deterrence and defense because of Afghanistan and because of other adventures that have not gone so well. Secondly, on President Biden, don't think that the Afghanistan chaos does not cost him politically at home. On the contrary, it does. But what does it mean for us? Does it mean that we should bandwagon with those people commenting negatively and end up again with a Trump presidency in 2024? I'm not sure if that's the right way to go about this. Anyway, it's beyond our competency. In any case, that belongs to the American people and not to us. Thirdly, on strategic autonomy, I do believe that some strategic autonomy is necessary. Let me just give you an example. In order to move a battalion of tanks from Constanza to Riga, it takes more than a month. Now, in our age of very short lightning speed, this is unbearable. So we have to work on the military mobility aspect of the European defense, as little as it is. And unfortunately, and I'm going to speak with my budget rapporteur hat, unfortunately, Europe does not put enough money in this. And I think we should do our homework at home before criticizing the US for not being there or for doing things wrongly, etc. Thirdly, without the American support, we could not even withdraw the people, the citizens we did withdraw from Afghanistan. So I have to always remind ourselves of the size of the American intervention and of their forces, and to be aware that this is a sine qua non. This is a force without which, you know, Europe would be overrun in a very short amount of time if we didn't have the American backing and the support of NATO. Lastly, I do believe that the issue of refugees is something that Romania cannot escape from, in the sense that we are an international partner, and as such, we have also international obligations. So I listened to what Commissioner Ylva Johansson has said and others who have committed support to those member states offering refugee support. Now, there is I looked at our refugees centers. There's a new one being built in Crevedia. There's the one in Bucharest that's under reconstruction that can house, I believe, 300. There's those ones in Timiș, in Giurgiu, and Galați. So our entire Romanian capacity is somewhere around 1,000, I believe. And Romania has an obligation, because it participates in all these theaters of war, to also be there on the soft power side. And I do believe that many of the Afghan women, just as my Bulgarian colleague explained, or many of the children, or many of the staff that have worked with the 30,000 Romanian soldiers that were there, deserve perhaps a fresh chance in Europe. And I'm going to conclude by saying one thing. Thank you to our troops. Thank you to our troops. You have done an amazing job in a very difficult situation. And even more, being understaffed and underprepared in comparisons with your other NATO troops. I've talked to many soldiers and captains and who have told me that their daily per diem is much smaller than what an American, Canadian, etc. soldier gets. I've talked to soldiers who said that they've had to buy personal protection equipment in order to go to war zones, to buy it themselves, you know, Kevlar vests and etc. This is unacceptable, and we as a nation should learn how to invest again in our military and be proud of our boys when they go far, and to really respect their work, not just by declarations, like many of the populist politicians do now in Romania, but by deeds, by allocating sufficient budget for our forces, because the world in which we live in does not get easier, it only gets more complicated.
Okay. Mr. Nistor, you heard Mr. Ștefănuță, what he said about our rather modest capacity to receive refugees from Afghanistan. And what do you think about the Romania's capacity to, let's say, to contribute to the general EU effort to receive refugees from Afghanistan in this situation? And what do you think about our, responsibility in this entire crisis?
Yes, before answering to this question, I must say something more about the first topic after Mr. Stefanuzzo's intervention. I am also a philo-Atlantist, and in the moment when even our high representative has some disgust attitudes about the future of the relation with the United States, I was very firm and very clear in this sense. And of course, I don't want America to go back to a regime as the regime of the previous president was. No. But all this retreat was unfortunately not a glorious one for the United States, who is the house of democracy in this world. What was not a glorious one for the troops, NATO, the rest of the NATO troops, partially because they were prepared but in the time of the previous administration. The responsibility is mainly a military one and a diplomatic one, not entirely, not exactly a political one. But we must learn from our mistakes. And Romania was one of the main contributors, even with Romanian soldiers' lives in this war. And that's why Romania must be proud of this effort and must ask for more from their allies in conditions like that. Speaking about the possibility of migration, of Afghan migration in the direction of Europe, unfortunately or unfortunately, I don't know what's the correct formula, we don't know exactly how large will this be. You know, in that 4 million refugees in Turkey, around one third of them are also from Afghanistan. There are a lot of Syrians, the most of them, but there are Afghans coming in the last 2 and 3 years. But of course, now the number of them will increase. But we don't know exactly how many they will be. And Romania is obliged from the humanitarian reasons, political reasons, and a lot of other reasons to make possible to integrate a larger number of political refugees from Afghanistan, mainly because Romania was there for 20 years and, I repeat, intentionally was one of the main contributors.
But do you think we have Romania, Bulgaria, do you think we have the capacity to cope with this situation?
This must be a political decision in Bulgaria and in Romania. And depends what we will decide, we, the political bodies, the political parties, the political decidents to do with it, and how to influence positively the public opinion, because that is also a problem. And I think that it is the political decidents in these countries are obliged to be on the same wave with the rest of the democratic world.
Mrs. Ionceva, you had an extensive experience as a journalist in conflict zones. You've been to Afghanistan also, but in many other places, to Iraq, Chechnya, Kosovo. What do you think would, and you also, I remember you also documented this issue of illegal migration through Bulgaria. What do you think about any kind of risk, terrorist risk, terror threats that could come with, a new wave of refugees or migrants?
Well, first let me say about the big risk of the terrorist movement in Afghanistan that maybe could spread, could target European countries. This is the biggest risk. And for me, we just discuss about the withdrawal of American and NATO troops. I don't think this is the biggest problem, because NATO and America can't stay forever. We can't stay forever in Afghanistan, first. And second, the history shows that with no country could control Afghanistan. You can see what happened with the British Empire, with Russia, now with American and NATO troops. So in Afghanistan, we need to have another mean, not military, but another mean of communication. As you said, but the biggest problem is not, as I said, the withdrawal, but the weapons that American NATO left in Afghanistan, and this is understandable, $83 billion weapons, munitions for $83 billion or more, it's now in the hand of the Taliban, and maybe probably in the hand of different terrorist groups. And this is the bigger danger. But as many politicians said already, the fight in Afghanistan never been for Afghanistan. It's a fight and for influencing the neighboring countries. So maybe this is the explanation. But as you said, one of the biggest threats is the terrorism. And last but not least, we have to ensure that the return of the Taliban doesn't lead to a large-scale migration movement toward Europe, because Bulgaria and Romania as well is one of the entry point of Europe. So we should not allow one country to take the whole responsibility. And that's why Bulgaria and Romania should do everything that it's in their power to have some leverage, some mean of influence in Afghanistan. And the European as well. In this regard, I think the resumption of the European diplomatic presence on the ground is very important. We need to have our sources of information. We need to have our eyes there, and not to be surprised. As Mr. Borrell 1 month ago said, we were surprised by the event in Afghanistan. We can't be surprised. It's our duty not to be surprised. So, something else. By being present on the ground, we will have the opportunity to strengthen the cooperation with other countries who are on the ground, the country in the region, and partners that are presented on the ground. Of course, with the neighboring countries, with Turkmenistan, Tajikistan, with Russia and China, because they're on the ground, and they have, it seems, quite big influence for the moment, or at least they have a good way of communication with the regime. You need to be very practical. We need to be very practical in order to defend the human rights in Afghanistan, but also to defend our European interests, to defend Romania and Bulgaria of future non-illegal migratory movement.
Okay, so in your resolution, the European Parliament said that the European Union should engage operationally with the Taliban without officially recognizing them. As a mechanism, how could we engage operationally with the Taliban without officially recognizing them?
Yes, we can do this, and we are doing this, by the way. The European Union has the ambassador, and I asked him 2 weeks ago about his contacts with the Taliban, and he said they have talks, not just now, but before in Doha. You know that the movement of the Taliban, they have their representative, official representative in Doha. So, to lead negotiation, we don't need to recognize them. And I don't see that we can recognize them because they don't, at least for the moment, and I don't see how it's going to be in the future, they don't respond to any values, human values for the moment with this establishing of Islamic Emirates. So we are waiting to know how they're going to behave toward women, toward children, toward human rights.
Yes, in the resolution you stress this idea to enforce some kind of fast track visa for the Afghan women, and also says in the resolution no forced return to Afghanistan under any circumstances. Can we give this blank check to all the people from Afghanistan coming to Europe? Mr. Ștefănuță, what do you think about it?
There is no blank check, and our security services do a very tough screening on who's coming and who's allowed to stay. So I don't believe that we should accept willy-nilly without any kind of check. And I think the main priority should be towards the refugees who are going to go to the neighboring countries. Even though the neighboring countries, if you look at the map, you know, they're not particularly credible allies. I mean, Pakistan is one of the main neighbor and refugee recipient. If you can completely trust what's going on there, that's another discussion. But as regards the refugees that come towards Europe, we have to be 100% sure, and we have to be part of the security discussion organizations. We have to be part of Five Eyes and to get our intelligence from anywhere we can so that we don't let any terrorist come to Europe.
Mr. Nistor, I know you are in a hurry. Can you stay with us a little bit more?
For 5 minutes, yes.
5 minutes, okay. Please, your last intervention. Recently, the EU Justice and Home Affairs Council adopted a statement on the situation in Afghanistan. So it says, for example, based on lessons learned, the EU and its member states stand determined to act jointly to prevent the recurrence of uncontrolled large-scale illegal migration movements faced on the past by preparing a coordinated and orderly response. So the ministers of the 27 EU countries fear of this large-scale migration, and they say that the EU countries should take proper measures. Do you think we are prepared to take proper measures against illegal migration, but still protect the refugees coming from Afghanistan?
I hope so. As I've told you, normally our special services and also our states must have a very clear, must have a lot of clear informations about the persons who are our employees, who cooperated with the Romanian military and civilian presence there. And perhaps the same thing is in all our countries, including Bulgaria. Secondly, of course, as Mr. Ștefănuță just said, it is it's obvious that all the persons in these special times entering legally in Europe must be controlled. But the key word here is cooperation. That means cooperation between all the EU countries, because even if Bulgaria and Romania are not yet members of the Schengen area, we are a common space. We are a family of not only of principles, not only of democratic conventions, but we are really a family. And from that perspective, even the European area must be controlled together. And it is happening in some occasions. In this special case, That's the answer, cooperation between all the European states.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Nister. If you want to retreat, we would continue with Mrs. Ionceva and Mr. Ștefănuță for a few minutes more. Let's look at the question. We have some questions from our Hot News readers. One of them says, why was the situation in Afghanistan not publicly and transparently communicated? And about the balance of Romania's participation in this war, how much was the total cost? So Romania, more than anything, lost 27 men in Afghanistan in these 19 years of presence, of Romanian presence there, and other 200 Romanian soldiers were injured in the war. So, but you see that people are concerned about the cost of this war for Romania and other allies, Bulgaria also, and they don't see the results as far as we can see here. Mr. Ștefănuță, what do you think is the main achievement of these 20 years war, if we can say like such thing, achievement here?
The achievement is credibility. The achievement is credibility and solidarity. NATO is a collective defense mechanism, and every now and then we have to lose lives and jump in for the defense of our allies. Now, there could be a question if this was a justified war, if this was a timely war, if this is what we should have done. But Romania made the political commitment to go in, and as such has proven to be a reliable ally. We have donated, in this sense, 27 lives, as you said, and many more who are injured. We have spent billions of euros, probably, in keeping and maintaining a force for 19 years. But the result is that we have credibility in NATO. I'm always wondering about Article 5, whether it will be really respected when push comes to shove. But the only way to know for sure is to do it ourselves when this is triggered. So, you know, many people might wonder, was it worth it, etc. That is how you act when you are part of a team. You discuss options, you try to avoid war as much as possible. But if the organization decides that this is what we're doing, you should be ready and you should provide the help so that others provide help when you are in need. So about the communication, about the question from your reader, I believe that the reader is correct. But also I would like to turn the question to him or to her. How much did we care during these 19 years? How much did we ask how our troops are doing? How much did we request to see materials on TV or anywhere else about them? How many times did we want to donate for them? How many times did we check on their families? So it goes both ways, you know. It's not only that the army or the government should communicate more, but also we as a people should care more.
Another question says, shouldn't someone, the head of the state or the executive, have gone out and addressed the families of the victims in public, explaining that their loved ones did not die there in vain? Do you think, Mr. Ștefănuță, that our president or our head of the government, the presidents,
definitely,
the power of presidents should...
I have seen President Macron in front of the body of Jean-Paul Belmondo, you know, and I was thinking, this is perhaps an unrelated story, but I was thinking that our president should honor more the heroes of this nation and should always be there. In America, I know that that politicians and members of government make it a very important thing to go to the homes of veterans and deliver in person the nation's flag when somebody passes away. Or the veteran services are very developed in America, that they get pension, they get health insurance, they get many benefits, as they should. I'm not sure our veterans are treated as well, and we should always pay respect to our veterans because they are very, very important for the security of our nation.
Mrs. Yonceva, I come to you again. Please tell us about these resolutions that you negotiated. What kind of effect could have such a resolution, given the fact that it is a political one, it's not a, a legislative act?
Yes, look, after 20 years of presence in Afghanistan, we did a lot of mistakes, a lot of faults, political, from the political point of view, security, economical, financial. So there are many lessons to take from Afghanistan. But the main lesson that the European Union is taking is that we need to have effective European foreign policy toward Afghanistan in the future, not just toward Afghanistan. And this happened, all those mistakes happened because the European Union, yes, we donated, but at the same time, I don't think we were very active in Afghanistan politically. I don't believe that the situation in Afghanistan could be can be improved with the military means. As I said, many empires, the countries in the past, they tried to do this and they failed. So now we need to look for different means of influence and cooperation. But if you look for what happened for the last 20 years, there's some positive impact on the women and children education. You can see the figures, and they prove that the improvement was very, very important. So we don't know if the Taliban regime will keep this this tendency, but at least for the last 20 years, we can recognize, looking at the figures, that there has been some improvement on that direction, and this is very important. But what we had also a very big failure regarding the opium and heroin production, as I said from the beginning. So why that happened? It's a big question that should be analyzed here also in Brussels, because all this opium production, it fuels and continue to pump different terrorist group that the real danger for the European security.
We have also an online poll here on Hot News, and already we received almost 500 votes on our online polls. The half of our respondents are let's say worried about the pressure of migrants after this retreat from Afghanistan, and 16% are worried about the terrorist risk. 23% consider that Romania wouldn't be affected by this war, and 11% think that the influence of the US in Romania will decrease. So, Mr. Ștefănuță, what do you think about these opinions, this poll? Half of the respondents are worried about some kind of a pressure, migratory pressure. Do you think the Romanian people have reasons to worry about a wave of migrants or refugees?
Yes, and I believe that it is justified. It is justified because As another interlocutor said, that the retreat, you know, for America, it might be easy to retreat in that sense because of geography, but it leaves us with dealing with the results of this retreat, also because of geography. And in addition to that, I would like to say that probably in very few years, we will have a renewed pressure of migrants, and those will be not only from war zones, but climatic migrants. And we should really think what we are going to do about that, because with climate change, pressures from countries that will literally become uninhabitable because of climate crisis will create a big pressure to go north. Now, I know that it's very nice and convenient to think that borders might solve that, but borders will not solve everything. Borders will not solve everything. So we have to have a broader type of understanding. That's what I don't understand sometimes about people who are at the same time against migrants and at the same time they deny climate change, for instance. I don't think you can do that both, you know, because it's just a nonsense in a sense. So we have to really think in terms of decades, in terms of how we plan to be safe from this kind of pressures in the future. And when I relate to the situation in Afghanistan, I'm thinking that we have to stop it at the source, if possible, to stop it within the borders of the neighbors, to continue with the humanitarian aid, to try to evacuate those people who are really, really in need, because they face incredible pressures. Now, we shouldn't also think that all of the population of Afghanistan wants to migrate. That's not something feasible. But at the same time, we should think of stopping this phenomenon at the source. And I urge people who criticize our policy on migration, on Turkey, etc., to understand the pressures that the European Union is dealing with, and how much more important it is to solve the problem at the source, and not only when it comes to our doors. Because when it comes to our doors, it is already way too late, and borders will not be sufficient.
Okay, great. Thank you for this discussion and debate. Mrs. Ionceva, Mr. Ștefănuță, if you want to add something at the end of our debate, please go ahead, Mrs. Ionceva.
Yes, thank you very much. I understand the concern of many people in Europe, in Romania, in Bulgaria, about illegal migration, and that's why we need urgently to create conditions for humanitarian aid on the ground in Afghanistan in order to reach the citizens that are in a really difficult situation. So this is something that the European Union should do now, really to help the people who are in need in Afghanistan.
Okay, good. Thank you. Mr. Ștefănuță, please, if you want to have your final word in this debate.
If you'll also allow me to say a sentence in Romanian, is that possible?
Yes, please.
Yes. Vreau să vorbesc și cu cei care ne privesc și poate nu au înțeles engleza așa de bine. Ce vreau să spun sunt următoarele mesaje. Noi suntem un partener internațional devotat NATO și acest lucru este important pentru că ne ajută și pe noi. Pentru că aliații, după ce i-am ajutat în numeroase rânduri, se vor gândi și la ajutorul de care avem noi nevoie. Și credeți-mă că avem nevoie de ajutor de securitate aici, la Marea Neagră. Credeți-mă că nu suntem într-o zonă foarte pacifistă și cu anumite presiuni va crește nesiguranța noastră. Și atunci este foarte important să rămânem membri devotați ai NATO. 2. Este foarte important și ca Uniunea Europeană să stea pe propriile picioare în materie de apărare, pentru că nu este normal să mișcăm material militar dintr-o țară în alta și să dureze săptămâni și luni. Mobilitatea militară e esențială. Toate aceste lucruri trebuie să se întâmple în cadrul Uniunii Europene și noi trebuie să dărâmăm barierele care încă există. 3. Ca parteneri internaționali, trebuie să facem și noi un amar de bine uneori oamenilor, refugiaților, pentru că și nouă ne-au făcut alții bine atunci când eram într-o situație extrem de proastă. Gândiți-vă la anii 90 cu operațiuni Vilaj Umen, când se trimiteau ajutoare din vest, când toate țările occidentale încercau să fie solidare cu noi. Așa trebuie să facem și noi din când în când. Este creștinește, este normal, este firesc și mai este și diplomație internațională sănătoasă. Un ultim cuvânt, mulțumesc tare mult că v-ați uitat la dezbaterea noastră și sper că ați învățat că ceva ce se întâmplă atât de departe cum e în Afganistan are un impact și asupra vieții noastre. România nu este o insulă, ci este conectată la tot ce se întâmplă în lume. Mulțumesc.
Mulțumesc.
Thank you, Miss Ionceva.
Thank you very much, Miss Ionceva. Thank you, Mr. Ștefănuță. Bye-bye.